Right. The music is this man's adventure. This man's a terrifying force. It was too risky. He turned back down. To refuse the adventure is to run the risk of drying up like a peony shell. He could not refuse it. Subject to sudden storms and open to winds of terrifying force, from burning heat under the midday sun to intense cold light. The glare of sunlight can blind the man, the cold can freeze the blood in his veins, and then their hips and mortar, their panting and dying. To some extent, their bodies begin to die. Adventure.
Let's go. a little churchyard just along the way. Used to be land of spines to rake. Tombstone, epitaph, reeds, flowers, all that. All the work done lost. Someone dropped a bomb on the lot. And in this little yard there's a little old man with a little shovel in his little bitty hand. He seems to spend all his days puffing fags and digging graves. He hates the Reverend Vicar and he lives all alone in his home. Excuse me. Please, Mr. Grave Digger, don't feel ashamed as you dig little holes for the dead and the maimed. Please, Mr. Grave Digger, I couldn't care if you found a golden locket full of some girl's hair and you put it in your bucket. Pour it. A mother doesn't know about your sentimental joy. She thinks it's down below with the rest of her toys. A ma wouldn't understand, so I won't tell. So keep your golden locket all safely hid away in your pocket. Yes, Mr. D, you see me every day. Standing in the same spot by a certain grave. Mary Ann was only 10, full of life and oh so gay. And I was the wicked man who took her life away. Very selfish, oh God. No, Mr. GD, you won't tell. And just to make sure that you keep it to yourself, I've started digging holes, my friend, and this one here's for you.
I am carried on by some kind of divine prompting. No one else cares for it hereabouts. They rather make a scorn of it. And yet I can affirm that I have brought some things from utter darkness into a thin mist. It is a pity my book of lives should be buried in oblivion. Dame Olive Sherrington, being in love with John Talbot, the younger brother of the Earl of Shrewsbury, and her father not consenting with the marriage, discoursed one night with her lover from the battlements of the Abbey Church. Said she, "I will leap down to you." And her sweetheart replied, "And I will catch you." Never dreaming she would have done it. She leaped, and the wind, which was exceeding high, did come under her coats, and did something break her fall. Master Talbot caught her in his arms, and she struck him dead. She was my honored friend. Anno Domini, 1651, being about 100 years old, she died.
Mind you were a big grandfather.
Nowadays, surliness and inurbanity are far too common in England. A better instance of a squeamish and disobliging fellow cannot be found than in Gwynne, the Earl of Oxford's secretary. Oh, he cut some sour faces that would turn the milk in a fair lady's breast. No, this Earl of Oxford, Edward de Vere, in making his low obeisance,
thank you. John could run very fast, and when he had races with his friends, he always won. But one day, John woke up feeling really ill. He tried to get up, but his legs were so wobbly he could hardly cross the room. He sat on his bed and felt all shivery. Johnny, breakfast ready, called his mother, but John just sat and shivered. He really felt very, very ill. Soon his mother came out to see what was the matter. What's the matter?